الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد continue our discussion about the narration of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم which is متفق عليه from the hadith of معاوية ابن أبي سفيان رضي الله عنهما من يريد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين من يريد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين. Who has memorized the narration? من يريد الله من يريد من يريد من يريد الله من يريد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين. Who memorized the narration? من يريد الله به خيرا. Say it. Man yurid Allah bihi khayran yufaqihu fi ddin. All together one time. Man yurid Allah bihi khayran yufaqihu fi ddin. Ahsanta. You're going to teach your brother, right? You're going to teach your brother, right? So he's going to come tomorrow, next class. Yawm al-Ahad. Later to this name, Sunday night. Inshallah. It's gonna Okay. Who else memorized the narration? Man yuridillahu bihi khayran yufaqihu fi ddin. From the most beneficial and important narrations in the life of a Muslim. Who else? Ibrahim. Oh, you're gonna tune him up. Huh? You're gonna tune him up.
No.
And he's gonna teach him.
No.
Huh? And you guys already got it. MashaAllah. Allahumma barik. Ahmed. Had. Hadith.
Hadith.
Uh-huh.
Man yuridillahu bihi. Man yuridillahu bihi.
Khayran.
Khayran. Yufaqihu.
Fi.
Fi
ddin. Yufaqihu. Fi ddin. Ahsanta. Ahsanta. Who else can recite for us? Naam. Ahsanta, ahsanta, very good recitation, very good reading. Barakallahu fiqh. Who narrated it? Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, radiallahu anhuma. Radiallahu anhuma. May Allah be pleased with the both of them. What does that mean? With Muawiyah and Abu Muawiyah. Yani is, who was Abu Sufyan? Huh? Who was Abu Sufyan, radiallahu anhuma? Who collected the narration? Al-Bukhari. And Muslim, Al-Bukhari and Muslim. Man yuridillahu bihi khayran yufaqihu fi ddin. Yufaqihu fi ddin. We are reading some benefits with regards to the issues of al-fiqhu fi ddin. And as the author, he mentioned, rahimahullahu ta'ala, that the sign Allah, he wants good for someone is that he will grant him al-fiqhu fi ddin. The sign that Allah, he wants good for someone is that he will grant him al-fiqhu fi ddin, understanding, a proper and sound understanding of the religion of Allah Azza wa Jal. And also the contrary is understood from that. Also the contrary is understood for that. The one whom Allah did not intend good for, then He will not grant him an understanding in the religion. And then He will not grant him an understanding in the religion. Then He will not grant him an understanding in the religion. So this person here who does not have an understanding in the religion and he's not striving to gain an understanding in the religion, he's from the worst of mankind. He's from the furthest away from the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. He's from the most severely misguided and far away from goodness in this life. There's no good in the likes of this person. The one who does not have an understanding in the religion and he's not trying to seek an understanding in the religion, then he's the furthest of the people from goodness and from mercy, wa liya'udhu billah. And Allah Azza wa Jal, He guides whom He wills as a favor and a grace from Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we ask Him from His grace and His mercy to guide us. To guide us and to grant us an understanding in His religion. To guide us and our families and our loved ones and all of the believers. To guide our hearts and to grant us an understanding in the religion. In our previous class, we were discussing the narration of Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu, which is found in Jami' al-Tirmidhi, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خَصْلَتَانِ لَا تَجْتَمِعَانِ فِي مُنَافِقٍ, that there are two characteristics and traits, they will never be gathered in a hypocrite. They'll never come together in a hypocrite. حُسْنُ سَمْتْ وَلَا فِقْهٌ فِي الدِّينِ, having good, noble manners, conduct and demeanor, and also not having understanding in the religion. So this is an encouragement to have these affairs, that a person, he should strive to have understanding in the religion, and he should couple that understanding with noble manners and conduct and behavior. And that understanding should bring about and produce for him noble conduct, manners, and behavior. So the true issue of having fiqh in the deen is having knowledge that will bring about the fruits of piety and the fear of Allah. And that will bring about the fruits of action. The fruits of action. Performing the obligations properly in the manner prescribed and avoiding the prohibitions entirely and staying away from them and avoiding them in the manner prescribed and seeking forgiveness for one's shortcomings and sins all the way through this. All while on this path. So the true fiqh and the true knowledge that is beneficial is the one that will sink into the heart. That one that will sink into the heart in person, he will speak about it. It will sink into the heart and then it will be apparent on the tongue, and likewise it will produce the noble and upright lofty actions. And it will produce khashya, fear and reverence and love of Allah. And likewise it will produce taqwa, piety and righteousness in the heart, which likewise produces those noble and good actions. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, in his work Miftah Dar As-Sa'ada, the key to the home of happiness, on page 247 in the first volume, he has some beneficial commentary about the narration of Abi Hurairah radiyallahu anhu and the narration of Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu. I mean, the topic is related directly. The issue here of having a fiqh in the deen and the fact that the one who has fiqh in the deen, this is a sign Allah, he wants good for him. Barakallahu feekum, a sign that Allah wants good for somebody, this means the sign that Allah loves them. A sign that Allah loves them. A sign that Allah is showing them mercy. A sign that Allah is pleased with them. A sign that Allah will pardon them and forgive them. A sign that Allah will not take them to account for their sins and their shortcomings and their faults. This is what that means. Man yuridi lahu bihi khayran yufaqihu fid din. And in that Allah, he wants good for them, meaning that Allah, he loves them. Allah, he loves them. Allah, he loves them. Allah, he will show them mercy. Allah, he will forgive them. Allah, he will pardon them. Allah, he will answer them when they call on him. Whenever they seek his refuge, he will provide them refuge and safety. Whenever they seek his help, Allah, he will help them and aid them. And whenever they are afraid, Allah will comfort them and protect them. This is the one whom Allah wants good for. He will grant him understanding in the deen. The one whom Allah loves and is pleased with, he will grant him understanding in the deen. The one whom Allah aids and supports and protects and guides, he will grant him understanding in the deen. So this is of utmost importance. Now we see the title again, Faradu Talib al-Ilm, the obligation of seeking knowledge. So the author, he's using this narration to clarify the obligation of seeking knowledge. The obligation of seeking knowledge. A person, he has to stand up and seek knowledge. He has to make effort and seek knowledge in hopes that Allah wants good for him. And hopes that Allah wants good for him, and seek the help and the aid of Allah Azza wa Jal all the while, and hope that Allah wants good for him in order to obtain that knowledge, to apply it, to draw near to Allah Azza wa Jal. So it's an obligation. It's an obligation from this aspect. Also, the hadith that he mentioned as well that we read, that's even more clear to the point of the mas'ala that we're discussing, طالب العلم فريضة. طالب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم. We'll discuss this one بإذن الله تعالى in the classes to come. Speaking about the issue of this narration, that a hypocrite, these two traits, they'll never come together. These two traits, they'll never come together in a hypocrite. And that is to have good, noble manners and demeanor, to carry oneself with nobility and honor, and husn samt, wala fiqhun fi din, and also not having an understanding in the religion. If this is the issue of hypocrisy, either pure hypocrisy or hypocrisy in action, and we could either explain it in a manner understood, al-nifaq, Al-i'tiqadi, yani al-nifaq al-khalis, wali'adhu billah, pure nifaq and hypocrisy in creed, or it can be described, also understood, in al-nifaq al-amali, hypocrisy in action, yani a weakness in faith. So therefore, from the completion and perfection of faith, and to be free from hypocrisy, a person, he needs to have fiqh in the deen, and he needs to have good and noble manners, and carry himself with nobility and honor, dignity and respect. We understand this? Now the statement of Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala. He says, بَلْ لَمْ يُكُنَ السَّلَفْ يُطْلِقُونَ إِسْمَ الْفِقْهِ لَمْ يُكُنَ السَّلَفْ يُطْلِقُونَ إِسْمَ الْفِقْهِ إِلَّا عَلَى الْعِلْمِ الَّذِي يَسْحَبُهُ الْعَمَلِ. He says, but rather the salaf, the pious and the righteous predecessors, they did not used to use the word al-fiqh except to refer to the knowledge that is accompanied by action. The statement is amazing. The statement is very beneficial to ponder and to reflect upon. The Salaf, the pious predecessors, those whom upheld the religion properly and they carried it to those after them correctly, those whom Allah had chosen to be the carriers of the deen, Hamalatul Qur'ani wa Sunnah wa Tawheed, those whom Allah selected and chose to be the righteous and the best of this generation, لَمْ يُكُنَ السَّلَفْ يُطْلِقُونَ إِسْمَ الْفِقْهِ إِلَّا عَلَى الْعِلْمِ أَلَذِي يَسْحَبُهُ الْعَمَلِ لَمْ يُكُنَ السَّلَفْ يُطْلِقُونَ إِسْمَ الْفِقْهِ إِلَّا عَلَى الْعَمَلِ أَلَذِي يَسْحَبُهُ إِلَّا عَلَى الْعِلْمِ أَلَذِي يَسْحَبُهُ الْعَمَلِ إِلَّا عَلَى الْعِلْمِ أَلَّذِي يَسْحَبُهُ الْعَمَلِ. That the Salaf, they did not used to use this word fiqh except to refer to the knowledge that is accompanied by action. So in the tongue of the Salaf, in the statements of the scholars of the previous generations, when they discussed the issue of fiqh, what they understood from that is the type of knowledge and understanding that's accompanied with action. So therefore a person, if he has knowledge but he does not implement it and apply it in the right manner, he's not considered having knowledge. He's not considered having knowledge. This is not true knowledge. This is not beneficial knowledge. He has knowledge, but it's not beneficial for him because he opposes it and does not apply it and implement it in his life. Because he does not apply it and implement it in his life. So rather, it's more proper to call him jahil, or min ajhar al-nas. This person here will be considered with the set of min ajhar al-nas, from the most ignorant of the people. He has knowledge. He has knowledge of the deen, of the revelation, of the legislation, of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he does not apply it properly. This one is even more severe than the one who did not even know. He's even more ignorant than the one who did not even know. So Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, here he mentions a number of narrations that are very beneficial with regards to this affair from the Salaf, yani, to support what he's mentioning about the fact that the Salaf, they did not used to use this term al-fiqh except to refer to the knowledge that is accompanied by action. He says, Sa'd ibn Ibrahim ibn Abdurrahman ibn Auf, yani from the lineage and the relatives of one of the 10 companions who have been granted glad tidings of paradise, Abdurrahman ibn Auf radiyallahu anhu. This is his grandson. So Sa'd ibn Ibrahim, rahimahullah, he died in the year 127 from the Tabi'in. He was asked, an afqahi ahli al-Madinah. Su'ila Sa'd ibn Ibrahim, an afqahi ahli al-Madinah. He was asked about the person in Medina, about the people of Medina, the one who has the most fiqh. Who has the most fiqh from the people of Medina? This is what he's asked, rahimahullah ta'ala. And his days likewise, there were individuals in Medina, 7 of them. They were known as Al-Fuqaha al-Saba'a. The seven fuqaha from the Tabi'in that were the most knowledgeable of the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all of them alive at the same time in Al-Madina. And they're known as Al-Fuqaha al-Saba'a. So they're asking, who's the most knowledgeable in Al-Madina? Listen to his response. He says, rahimahullah, فَقَالَ أَتْقَاهُمْ. Listen to the response of the Salaf. Two words. أَتْقَاهُمْ. The one who has the most piety. The one who has the most piety. Who is the most knowledgeable of the people of Medina? What is his understanding, rahimahullah? The one who has the most piety. He didn't say the one who has the most knowledge. The one who memorized the most narrations. The one who has the deepest understanding of the fiqh. Rather, he said, أَتْقَاهُمْ. The one who has the most taqwa. The one who has the most taqwa. And likewise, this is in reality supported. This understanding here is clearly supported from the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah, he mentioned in his book, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. That indeed, the most noble of you with Allah, the most honorable of you with Allah, is the one who fears Him the most. The one who has the most piety. The one who has the most piety. He says, وَسَأَلَ الفرقد السبخي الحسن البصري وسأل الفرقد السبخي الحسن البصري عن شيء فأجابه فقال إن الفقهاء يخالفونك. He says now, and الفرقد السبخي, also from the Tabi'in as well, he asked الحسن البصري, who was likewise from the Tabi'in. الحسن البصري well known, he died in the year 110. So one of his students is asking him now, his name is Farqad al-Sabakhi. He asked him an issue. He asked him about an issue in the religion, and he responded to him, فَقَالَ إِنَّ الْفُقَهَاء يُخَالِفُونَكَ إِنَّ الْفُقَهَاء يُخَالِفُونَكَ. So whenever he answered the question to him, now Farqad tells him, after hearing this response, he says, but the fuqaha, they're contrary to you. They differ with you. The fuqaha, they differ with you. He came and asked Al-Hasan al-Basri a question. Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahimahullah, he answered the question. Upon hearing the response, the man, he says to him now, but the fuqaha, the scholars of fiqh, they differ with you. They differ with you. And he meaning that they give a ruling different than what you're given. Different than what you're giving. Oh Hassan. So he says, Al-Hassan, he reprimands him now, clarifying, فَقَالَ Al-Hassan. Al-Hassan, he says, رَحِيمَهُ ثَكِلَتْكَ أُمُكَ يَا فُرَيْقِدْ. يَا فُرَيْقِدْ. He said, may your mother be bereaved of you, O little Farqad. We've seen this previously likewise, in the statement of Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhuma, whenever Urwa was in opposition to the hadith, holding firm to the position of Abu Bakr al-Umar. Whenever he said that, Ibn Abbas, he said the same thing, radiallahu anhu, ma yaqulu Urayya. What is little Urayya? What is little Urwa saying? And now he's being kind, at the same time he's letting him know his place. You're stepping up into a field in an arena that you don't belong in. You're saying something that is not qualified, little Urwa. Likewise here, what may your mother be bereaved of you, O little Farqad. ثَكِرَتْكَ أُمُكَ يَا فُرَيْقِدْ. Yeah, for a kid. And this is from the beauty, likewise, of the Arabic language. He says, وَهَا رَأَيْتَ بِعَيْنَيْكَ فَقِيهًا. He says, and have you, little Farqad, have you ever seen a true scholar with your two eyes? He's saying, the scholars, they differ with you. What is the ruling for this? Oh, Hassan. Oh, Hassan, he says, the ruling is this and that. He says, but the scholars, they differ with you. He says, may your mother be bereaved with you, little Farqad. Have you ever seen with your own two eyes a scholar, really, in your life? Have you ever seen with your own two eyes, really, a scholar in your life? He said, إِنَّمَا الْفَقِيهُ الزَّاهِدُ رَاغِبُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ الْبَصِيرُ بِدِينِهِ الْمُدَاوِمُ عَلَى عِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ الَّذِي لَا يَحْمِزُ مَنْ فَوْقَهُ وَلَا يَسْخَرُ بِمَنْ دُونَهُ وَلَا يَبْتَغِي عَلَى عِلْمٍ عَلَّمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى أَجْرًا. He said, the true faqih, the true person carrying fiqh, he is the one who is zahid. He's the one who is turning away from this life. الراغب في الآخرة. He's the one who has turned away from this life. He has abstinence in this life, and he has dedicated himself to the hereafter. And he is the one, البصير بديني. He's the one who has insight in his religion. He has insight in his religion. المداوم على عبادة ربه. The one who is constant. The one who is in constant devotion to the worship of his Lord. The one who is in constant devotion to the worship of his Lord. الذي لا يحمز من فوقه. The one who does not belittle or find fault with the ones who are above him. يعني in knowledge and in status. وَلَا يَسْخَرُ بِمَا دُونُهُ. And he likewise does not put down those who are below him. He does not find fault and talk bad about those who are above him in rank and status. And likewise, he does not put down and belittle those who are under him or lesser than him. And he does not seek by way of the knowledge that Allah has taught him a worldly gain. And he does not seek by way of the knowledge that Allah has taught him a worldly gain. And clarifying again the intent and the purpose of this now is to see the true fiqh. And the one who carries fiqh is called al-faqih. He's called al-faqih. He's the one who has fiqh. And the plural is al-fuqaha. Al-fuqaha. So the one who truly has fiqh, then this is his attribute. This is his characteristic. This is his description. This is his attribute. This is his characteristic. This is his description. This is his attribute. This is his characteristic. This is his description here. That he is somebody who his heart is attached to Allah. He's looking for the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's turning away from this life. He's dedicated to fulfilling the obligations of Allah and drawing near to Allah with that which is recommended. He's dedicated to avoiding it. He's striving against his soul and avoiding the prohibitions and staying away from that which is displeasing. That which is displeasing to Allah Azza wa Jal. The one who has insight and knowledge in his religion and his deen. The one who is constantly in devotion to the worship of his Lord. The one who does not find fault. And find fault with those who are above him, and nor belittle those who are below him, and he doesn't seek a worldly gain with his knowledge. This is the person who's truly holding at fiqh. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, وَقَالَ بَعْضُ السَّلَفِ. And some of the salaf they have mentioned, إِنَّ الْفَقِيهَ مَنْ لَمْ يُقْنِطْ النَّاسَ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ وَلَمْ يُؤَمِّنْهُمْ مِنْ مَكْرِ اللَّهِ وَلَمْ يَدَعْ الْقُرْآنَ رَغْبَةً عَنْهُ إِلَى مَا سِوَاهُ. Then some of the Salaf, they mentioned that the faqih, the true person carrying understanding in the religion, the true person who has understanding and is carrying knowledge in the religion, he is someone who did not, he's someone who does not cause the people to despair from the mercy of Allah, nor does he make them feel safe from the plot of Allah. And he does not leave the Qur'an, and he never leaves the Qur'an turning away from that, desiring to have something else. So this is also from the descriptions of a person who has fiqh. The person who is truly carrying knowledge, from his characteristics and traits, is that he would admonish the people, that he would advise the people, that he would direct the people, that he would encourage the people. But the one who truly has understanding in the deen, it will be in a moderate manner like this, and he will warn the people. If he sees the people upon falsehood or misguidance or traversing upon a bad way that could lead to their destruction or to their failure or could lead to deficiency in their faith and their religion, they're advancing upon misguidance, innovations, and corrupt ideologies, or they're advancing upon sin, or they're engulfed in sin and the like this, he would admonish them. He would remind them, but he would admonish them in a manner that would not cause them to despair and to give up hope in the mercy of Allah. And likewise, he would encourage them to do good, and he would encourage them to have high hopes in the mercy of Allah and in the forgiveness of Allah. But at the same time, he would do that in a manner that would not cause them to feel safe from the punishment of Allah. He'll mention the promise of mercy along with warning them. So he will not go to either extreme. So the person who is constantly admonishing the people and warning them and threatening and mentioning the verses of the punishment of the fire and the hellfire and tell the people they give up hope, oh, I'm from those people. And like this is foul, this is wrong. He doesn't have the proper understanding. And the one who's always mentioning the mercy of Allah and the grace of Allah and the forgiveness of Allah and the Allah, he's the most pardoning, and then he doesn't also encourage them to take the path, then now he is making them feel safe from the punishment of Allah. So also this is falsehood and not correct and not having good knowledge. Rather, to admonish the people to leave off the sins and to warn them from that, and likewise to encourage the people to seek a path that will lead to the mercy of Allah and His forgiveness in a moderate manner. This one is the one who has al-fiqhu fi al-deen. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من قال هلك الناس فهو أهلكهم فهو أهلكهم أو فهو أهلكهم. The one who said, oh, all of mankind is destroyed. Some people, they'll do that. They'll look into the society, they'll look into the ummah, and they'll say that, oh, the ummah is finished. Everyone is misguided. All of them are destroyed and misguided. Like this. And this is falsehood. And this person, he has truly not understood the affairs properly. Even though, no doubt, in our days, likewise, the falsehood and misguidance and desires are widespread, there are still people of goodness. And the sunnah is still established. And the people of the sunnah are still establishing the religion. And the khayr is still present. Walhamdulillah, the tawheed and the sunnah, salafiyah, sahih, is still present. Alhamdulillah. So no one will say, all of mankind is finished, everyone is misguided, everyone is in sins, everyone is involved in this, and everyone is like this, just completely making the people give up hope. As if everyone is misguided and we're from the worst of mankind, and the resurrection is going to be established upon us, so on and so forth, until they give up hope in the mercy of Allah and they delve even further into sin. And likewise, one will not just say to them all the time, oh Allah, He's most forgiving, most merciful, do whatever you like, like this, and tell the people they just also engulf in sins. Rather, the moderate path is the path of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, having fiqh in the deen, to encourage them to do good and to warn them from evil, to encourage them to do good and to warn them from evil, and to mention for them the pathways of both of them and how to traverse upon moderation. So he says, وَقَالَ إِبْنُ مَسْعُودٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ كَفَى بِخَشَّةِ اللَّهِ عِلْمًا وَبِالْإِقْتِرَارِ بِاللَّهِ جَهْلًا. Having true reverence and fear of Allah Azza wa Jal will suffice a person to be considered carrying knowledge. It will suffice a person to be considered having knowledge. And being deceived about Allah Azza wa Jal is sufficient to be considered ignorance. And it's sufficient to consider a person being ignorant. Any meaning that if he's deceived about Allah Azza wa Jal, about the mercy of Allah or the forgiveness of Allah or the deen of Allah and the likes like this, he has a misunderstanding in these affairs, then this is true ignorance. And this is true ignorance, regardless of how much knowledge he's carrying or how much Quran he has memorized or how many hadith he has memorized and the likes like this. If he's deceived about these affairs and he does not implement that knowledge in his life, then this is true ignorance. Then this is true ignorance. And likewise, Ibn Qayyim, he mentioned, rahimahullah ta'ala, wa wasafa Allahu ahla ma'siyatihi bil jahl fi qawlihi ta'ala. I need to emphasize this affair, that Allah, He has described those who disobey Him with ignorance. Allah has described those people who disobey, those who disobey Him with ignorance. And those who disobey Allah, Allah has mentioned that they are ignorant. في قوله تعالى, in the statement of Allah, the Most High, إنما التوبة على الله للذين يعملون السوء بجهالة ثم يتوبون من قريب فأولئك يتوب الله عليهم وكان الله عليما حكيما. That indeed repentance is only upon Allah for those, and that Allah, He will only accept the repentance of those who work evil upon ignorance, and then they repent soon after. And then they repent soon after. That Allah, He will only accept the repentance of those who work evil upon ignorance. Upon ignorance. And then they soon repent after that. It is these whom Allah, He will accept their repentance. And Allah, He is the all-knowing and the all-wise. And Allah, He is the all-knowing and the all-wise. ثُمَّ يَتُوبُونَ مِنْ قَرِيبٍ. It's been mentioned, ثُمَّ يَتُوبُونَ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَمُوتُوا. مِنْ قَرِيبٍ, that they repent. That they, then after that, they repent. They soon repent, meaning they repent before they die. Meaning they repent before they die. These are those whom Allah will accept their repentance. And Allah, He is the all-knowing and the all-wise. He mentioned, رحمه الله تعالى, قال سفيان الثوري. قال سفيان الثوري. سفيان الثوري, from the best of the scholars of hadith. أمير المؤمنين في الحديث. His name is Abu Abdullah Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri, rahimahullah ta'ala. He died in the year 161. He mentions here, كُلُّ مَنْ عَمِلَ ذَنْبًا مِنْ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ جَاهِلٌ سَوَاءً كَانَ جَاهِلًا أَوْ عَالِمًا وَإِنْ كَانَ عَالِمًا فَمَنْ أَجْهَلُ مِنْهُ وَإِنْ كَانَ عَالِمًا فَمَنْ أَجْهَلُ مِنْهُ. He says, everyone who acts in disobedience, everyone who commits a sin from the creation of Allah, then he's ignorant. كُلُّ مَنْ عَمِلَ ذَنْبًا مِنْ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ جَاهِلٌ. Everyone who works, who commits a sin, then he's ignorant. سَوَاءً كَانَ جَاهِلًا أَوْ عَالِمًا. سَوَاءً كَانَ جَاهِلًا أَوْ عَالِمًا. Regardless of whether he is jahil or alim, regardless of whether he is truly ignorant or whether he is a scholar, a person of knowledge, everyone who works in disobedience, committing sin, he's considered jahil. He's considered ignorant. He said, if he was in kana aliman faman ajhalu minhu, and if he was a scholar, a person of knowledge, then who is more ignorant than him? Then who is more ignorant than him? If he's a person of knowledge working in sin and disobedience, then who is more ignorant than him? Meaning that this person, he's more ignorant than the one who's ignorant himself, because he is choosing this ignorance upon knowledge. He's choosing this disobedience and this misguidance upon knowledge, showing preference to that. So this is even greater in ignorance. إن كنت لا تدري فتلك مصيبة وإن كنت تدري فالمصيبة أعظم. The poet, he says that if you did not know, then this is a calamity. I mean, somebody, he fell into sin or misguidance or into error. إن كنت لا تدري فتلك مصيبة. If you didn't know, then this is a calamity. This is a calamity. وإن كنت تدري فالمصيبة أعظم. But if you did know and you still did it anyways and fell into that, then this is even greater and more severe. Then this is even greater and more severe. So after this, he mentioned, rahimahullah ta'ala, Ali ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, ذَنْبُ al-mu'min جَهْلٌ مِنْهُ. ذَنْبُ al-mu'min جَهْلٌ مِنْهُ. That whenever a believer, he commits a sin, this is ignorance from him. This is an act of ignorance from him. A believer, when he falls into sin, he perpetrates that which is impermissible and violates those rights, or he falls short in performing the obligations, or he leaves them entirely. وَلِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ هَذَا جَهْلٌ مِنْهُ. This is considered ignorance. This is ignorance from a believer. A believer with knowledge, he would not do that. The only time this will happen from a believer is whenever he falls into a state of heedlessness and ignorance. At this time, he will commit sin. He says, رَحِمَهُ and Qatada ibn Diyama Sudusi, رَحِمَهُ ta'ala, he died in the year 117. From the students of Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, he says, أجمع أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن كل شيء عصي الله به فهو جهالة. فهو جهالة. The companions of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم ورضي الله عنهم, they have a consensus, they have a unified agreement that everything that is a means to disobey Allah is considered ignorance. Every means to disobey Allah is jahala. فَهُوَ جَهَالَ. This is a type of ignorance. As-Suddi, he mentioned likewise, As-Suddi, also from from the Tabi'in, from those who are well known for the explanation of the Quran, like Qatada and Ibn Abbas and radiallahu anhum and other than them. He says, "Kullu man asallah, fahuwa jahil." Kullu man asallah, fahuwa jahil. Everyone who disobeys Allah, then he's ignorant. Everyone who disobeys Allah, then he's ignorant. Going back to the previous statement of Sufyan, rahimahullah, and the one who disobeys Allah upon knowledge, he's the most ignorant. He's the most ignorant. And who is more ignorant than him? Then who is more ignorant than him? The one who advances and chooses disobedience and deviation and sin upon knowledge, what he knows. Upon knowledge, what he knows. This is a great crime and very dangerous for the soul. وَلِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ. So the Ibn Qayyim, he mentions that ذَنْبُ لَا يَقَعُ مَعَ كَمَالِ الْعِلْمِ. And this is summarized now, or summarized from the benefits there. He mentions, person, he will not fall into sin and disobedience whenever his knowledge is complete. If he has the complete knowledge. The only time he will fall into sin and disobedience is because of a deficiency in knowledge. It's because of a weakness in knowledge. The true knowledge will stop him. The true knowledge, which is in reality sincere and true faith, it will stop him from committing sin. It will stop him from committing sin. So the complete knowledge means al-Iman al-Sadiq. And the complete knowledge is whenever it goes into his heart, as we have seen, and produces the khashya and the taqwa. And now he fears Allah. And he's afraid of Allah. To the extent that fear will stop him. Stop him from violating the rights. Will carry him to perform the obligations. And in this manner like this, يَهْدِهِمْ رَبُّهُمْ بِإِيمَانِهِمْ. Their Lord guides them by way of their faith. Their Lord guides them by way of their faith. He mentioned an example, barakallahu fikum, that this person who disobeys Allah, at the time he is preparing to disobey Allah, maybe he's by himself, for example, if he knew that there was a child looking through a hole in the door, he would not advance. If he knew a baby, a child, a little boy, for example, or a little girl is playing and peeking through the doorway, at that moment he will not commit that sin. At that moment he will not commit that sin. What is stopping him? Huh? Shame. Ahsanta. Barakallah. Al-haya. Al-haya. Ahsanta. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Also, what is stopping him? If he didn't know he's there, would he go forth? He would go forth, right? He would go forth. If he didn't know there was a child there, if he didn't know anyone was watching him, what would he do? He would do it. That's what he's looking for. That's what he's looking for. But if he knew that there was even a child there watching him through a hole in the door, he will not perpetrate that sin. He will not perpetrate that sin. The brother, he said, because of shame, he's out of shame. He's shame. Because he knows, the point is, barakallahu fik, that shame comes from knowledge. So now he knows that that person is watching him. And that if that person sees him doing that, that's shameful. And he will feel bad. Some of them, they mentioned that they will be committing sin alone in their room, and suddenly the door will move and they will become very ashamed and very afraid, only to find out it was a cat moving through the hallway. Yani, and only to find out it's a cat moving the door and the lights like this. And so he's afraid to know who's going to watch me, who's going to see me. And the lights like this, all of a sudden feeling shame, and it's just a little cat yani, playing around the corner. Yani, to show how ignorant this person is. How ignorant this person is. So the one who has knowledge that someone is peeking through the doorway, that knowledge will stop him from committing the shameful and the indecent acts. For the shameful and the indecent acts. You see where he's going, rahimahullah? Where is he going?
He's going to the fact that if Allah sees him, he won't do it.
Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. That's fiqh in the deen. That's fiqh. The greatest fiqh in the deen is fiqh al-tawheed. To know the tawheed of Allah. That Allah, he has the most beautiful names and attributes of perfection, no deficiency in his life whatsoever. He's alive and never dies. He's powerful and strong and never weak. He feeds and he's not fed. He protects and no one can protect against him. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he sees all things at all times. And he sees and hears and knows all things at all times. And nothing is hidden from him. And everything that we have are from his favors and blessings that he has provided for us. So we cannot disobey him except with his blessings. Allah cannot be disobeyed except with his blessings. So the one who has complete knowledge of this affair, and he knows this certainly, and he recollects and remembers, this will stop him from committing that sin. So the only time that a person will fall into sin, even if he knows that Allah can see him, even if he's a person of tawheed, even if he knows the sunnah and the law and legislation and the halal and the haram, he will only continue to perpetrate that sin whenever he's heedless of that knowledge, or whenever he's forgetful of that knowledge, as if he's ignorant of that knowledge and did not know, or whenever he shows preference to his desires and whims upon knowledge, and he lusts for that, and he embarks upon that in any case. So this person, in all of these situations here, is considered jahil. He's considered jahil, the one who remembers that Allah can see him, Allah can hear him, Allah knows him and is aware of everything that he's doing. The one who knows that Allah has sent revelation, guidance, clarifying that which is allowed and permissible and lawful from that which is haram, impermissible and foul. Clarifying that Allah has sent messengers and prophets to clarify the right, the straight path, and the halal and the haram. And likewise, that Allah has also sent along in that revelation the glad tidings and a promise of paradise and mercy for those who obey him, and likewise have threatened those who fall short in fulfilling those actions of obedience. And there's a great threat and punishment in the hereafter for those who disobey. The one who remembers this affair and recollects this affair, this will stop him. So the one who knows this, yet he insists to disobey Allah Azza wa Jal, then no doubt he is jahil. Then no doubt he is jahil. This is ignorance. This is ignorance. So the benefit that we take is that true fiqh in the deen, and the true sign that Allah, he wants good for us, is that he will grant us this beneficial knowledge and the success to apply it in our life. He'll grant us the beneficial knowledge of the legislation and the guidance that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that knowledge will not be beneficial truly for us until we implement it in our life. Until we implement it in our life. Until that knowledge now becomes a guide for the action. A guide for the action. Like this, likewise, Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned another benefit with regards to knowledge. He says, Al-ilmu imamul amal wa qaidun lahu wal amalu tabi'un lahu wa mutammun bihi. فَكُلُّ عَمَلٍ لَا يَكُونُ خَلْفَ الْعِلْمِ مُكْتَدِيًا بِهِ فَهُوَ غَيْرُ نَافِعٍ لِصَاحِبِهِ فَهُوَ غَيْرُ نَافِعٍ لِصَاحِبِهِ. That knowledge is the imam. Everybody knows the imam, right? The imam, he's the one who leads the prayer. Right? He's the one who's in front. Knowledge, he's the imam. Knowledge is the imam of action. Knowledge is the imam of action. وَقَائِدٌ لَهُ. Knowledge is the imam of action. وَقَائِدٌ لَهُ. Al-ilmu, imam al-amali wa qa'idun lahu. He's the imam, the leader of action, and is guiding him and leading him. The qa'id is the one who's driving a car, he's called the qa'id. The one who's the leader of the army, he's called the qa'id. The one whom everybody is following behind, he's called the qa'id. He's called the qa'id. The one who's the imam, likewise, the people behind him, they follow him. And they don't move before, he moves. And likewise, the qa'id, the one who's leading and driving the forces in the army, no one makes a move except after he moves. So this is the case of knowledge and action. This is the case of knowledge and action. Knowledge is the leader and the guide of action. وَالْعَمَلُ تَابِعٌ لَهُ وَمُتَمٌ بِهِ. And the action is following behind the knowledge accordingly and properly. Just like how the imam, whenever he says Allahu Akbar, after that, those behind him, the ma'mumun, they say Allahu Akbar. Whenever the imam, he says Ameen, they say Ameen. Whenever the imam, he goes to Ruku, then they go to Ruku. Not before. So knowledge and action is like this. The knowledge, it comes first, and the action follows behind precisely. And the action follows behind precisely. He says, فَكُلُوا عَمَلٍ لَا يُكُونُوا خَلْفَ الْعِلْمِ مُكْتَدِيًا بِهِ فَهُوَ غَيْرُ نَافِيًا لِصَاحِبِهِ. So every action that is not behind knowledge and following in line with knowledge, then it's not beneficial for that person. Every action That's not behind knowledge. That's not following behind knowledge. That's not based upon knowledge. Then it's not beneficial for that person. No matter what he does, any salat that's not performed upon knowledge, it will not be beneficial for that person. Any charity, any seeking of knowledge, any memorization of the Quran, that's not behind. It has to be done upon knowledge. Al-ilmu qabala al-qawli wal-amal. Knowledge precedes every statement and action. That's the point of this affair. بل مضرّةٌ له. He said rather it will be harmful for him. The action that is not following in line with knowledge and based upon knowledge coming after knowledge, the action that's not preceded by knowledge and founded and based upon knowledge and following behind knowledge, it will not benefit that person. Rather, it will harm him. Rather, It would harm him. كما قال بعض السلف, just like some of the Salaf they have mentioned, من عبد الله بغير علم كان ما يفسد أكثر مما يصلح. Like some of the Salaf they have mentioned, that whoever worships Allah without knowledge, then the corruption that he works is more than the good. The corruption that he works is more than the good that he will work. He will work more corruption than good. Then he will work more corruption than good. Likewise, the one who speaks about knowledge as well. The one who speaks about the affairs of the religion without knowledge, then he will corrupt and work more evil than he does good. Then he does good. Everything has to be based upon knowledge. Al-Islam, deen ilm. The religion of Al-Islam is a deen of knowledge. Knowledge. Who الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق. Allah, he sent his messenger. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with guidance, knowledge, and the right and the religion of truth. So he says, رحمه ta'ala, وَالْأَعْمَالُ إِنَّمَا تَتَفَاوَتُ فِي الْقُبُورِ وَالرَّدِّ بِحَسْبِ مُوَفَقَتِهَا لِلْعِلْمِ وَمُخَالَفَتِهَا لَهُ. That the deeds, they vary with regards to being accepted or being rejected. The actions that we all perform, that the people they perform, they vary. They vary with regards to being accepted or being rejected. And this is in accordance, this is according to how well they are in accordance with knowledge or in contradiction to it. So the more the action is in accordance with the knowledge, the more hopefully and rightfully it will be accepted. And the more it is further away from knowledge. Not in accordance with the knowledge, meaning the knowledge that was revealed through Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then it's more likely to be rejected. وَالْعَمَلُ الْمُوَافِقُ لِلْعِلْمِ هُوَ الْمَقْبُولُ وَالْمُخَالِفُ لَهُ هُوَ الْمَرْدُودُ. And the action that is in accordance to knowledge, then it is the action that is accepted. And the action that is contrary, in contradiction to knowledge, then this action is rejected. فَالْعِلْمُ هُوَ الْمِيزَانُ وَهُوَ الْمِحَكُ. So therefore, knowledge, it is the scale, and is the criterion to distinguish and to determine. It is the criterion, it's the means to distinguish and determine. Knowledge. All of this is clarifying the great importance of knowledge, but also is clarifying for us as well that the goal of that knowledge is to have action. To have action, because the actions, this is what will be weighed. The actions, this is what will be weighed. Our actions are going to be weighed on the day of resurrection. We're going to meet Allah Azza wa Jalla, and our deeds are going to be weighed. Our deeds are going to be weighed. The deeds that are based upon knowledge, in accordance to the knowledge, then these are the deeds that will be accepted by the permission of Allah. And the deeds that are not in accordance to knowledge, they're contrary to the way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these deeds, they will be rejected. These deeds, they will be rejected. Just like in the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. Whoever does a deed that's not in accordance to our affairs, then it will be rejected. Then it will be rejected. He says, رحمه الله تعالى قال تعالى, that Allah the Most High, he says, الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا وهو العزيز الغفور. Mentioning the statement of Allah Azza wa Jalla, that Allah, He is the one who has created the death and the life to test you to see what's best indeed. And He is the Almighty and the Most Forgiving. He says, قال الفضيل بن عياض رحمه الله تعالى. الفضيل بن عياض, he died in the year 187 from the أتباع تابعين. He says here, وأخلص العمل وأصوبه. What does it mean here? What does it mean that Allah has created the death and the life to test them to see what's best indeed? What is the best deed? What is the best deed? الفضيل بن عياض رحمه الله تعالى answered this question. He said, وأخلص العمل وأصوبه. The best deed, أحسن العمل, هو أخلص العمل وأصوبه. It is the action that is done purely and sincerely for the sake of Allah and correctly. And correctly. They said to him, قالوا يا أبا علي, أو أبا علي, ما أخلصه وأصوبه. What does that mean? To be the most pure and most correct. قال إن العمل إذا كان خالصا ولم يكن صوابا لم يقبل. وإذا كان صوابا ولم يكن خالصا لم يقبل حتى يكون خالصا صوابا. فالخالص أن يكون لله والصواب أن يكون على السنة. So he mentioned رحمه الله تعالى that the action, if it was inwardly, sincerely, or purely for the sake of Allah, but it was not outwardly correct, then it will not be accepted. And if it was outwardly correct, but it was not inwardly, sincerely, purely for the sake of Allah, then it will not be correct. It will not be correct until it is inwardly, sincerely, purely for the sake of Allah, and outwardly correct. فَالْخَالِصُ أَنْ يَكُونَ لِلَّهِ. The one that is pure and sincere is the one that's for the sake of Allah alone. وَالصَّوَابُ أَنْ يَكُونَ عَلَى السُنَّةِ. And the one that is correct is the one that is in accordance to the sunnah. He says, رحمه الله ابن قيم, وقد قال تعالى, Allah the Most High, he says, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. And Allah the Most High, he says, the meaning of which is, and whoever hopes for the meeting of his Lord, then let him work righteous deeds. Then let him work righteous deeds and not associate any partners whatsoever in the worship of his Lord. He said, Rahimahullah, فَهَذَا هُوَ الْعَمَلُ الْمَقْبُولُ الَّذِي لَا يَقْبَلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْعَمَالِ السِّوَى وَهُوَ أَنْ يَكُونَ مُوَافِقًا لِسُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مُرَادٍ بِهِ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ مُرَادٍ بِهِ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ. So therefore, this is the action, the deeds that are accepted. This is the description of the deeds that are accepted. The deeds that Allah, He does not accept any other deeds besides them. And it is that it is in accordance to the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that the person, he attended the face of Allah by way of that. He did it sincerely and purely for the sake of Allah alone. The point he says, rahimahullah, وَلَا يَتَمَكَنُ الْعَامِرُ مِنَ الْإِتْيَانِ بِعَمَلٍ يَجْمَعُ هَذَيْنِ الْوَصْفَيْنِ إِلَّا بِالْعِلْمِ. And a person who's going to work to do righteous or good deeds, he is not able to do an action that gathers these two descriptions except by way of knowledge. A person, he can never truly do the action sincerely and purely for the sake of Allah until he learns about the details about ikhlas. And a person could never perform the action according to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam until he learns the details of the sunnah in that action. And that action, he says, فَإِنَّهُ إِن لَمْ يَعْلَمْ مَا جَاءَ بِهِ الرَّسُولُ sallallahu alaihi wasallam لَمْ يُمْكِنْهُ قَصْدُهُ. Because if he did not know that which the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with, he could not even intend to it. It's not possible for him to intend that. وَلَمْ يَعْرِفْ مَعْبُودَهُ لَمْ يُمْكِنْهُ إِرَادَتُهُ وَحْدَهُ. If he does not know the one whom he worships, he does not truly know Allah azza wa jalla, then it's not possible that he can intend to worship him alone. فَلَوْلَا الْعِلْمُ لَمَا كَانَ عَمَلُهُ مَقْبُولًا. So if it was not for knowledge, then his actions would not be accepted. فالعلم هو الدليل على الإخلاص هو الدليل على المتابعة. So knowledge is the guide that leads a person to ikhlas. Knowledge is the guide that leads a person to ikhlas, and knowledge is the guide that leads a person to be able to follow the sunnah. He says, وَقَدْ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. And Allah the Most High, He says, the meaning of which is, and indeed Allah, He only accepts from the people of التقوى. He says, وَأَحْسَنُ مَا قِيلَ فِي تَفْسِيرِ الْآيَةِ أَنَّهُ إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ عَمَلَ مَنْ اتَّقَاهُ فِي ذَلِكَ الْعَمَلِ وَتَقْوَاهُ فِيهِ أَنْ يَكُونَ لِوَجْهِهِ عَلَى مُوَفَقَةِ أَمْرِهِ وَهَذَا إِنَّمَا يَحْسُرُ بِالْعِلْمِ. So he says the best interpretation of this verse here, Allah, He only accepts from the people of at-taqwa, is that Allah, He only accepts the action that the person who performed it, he performed that action upon taqwa. إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah, He only accepts from the muttaqeen, the people of piety. What does that mean? The best interpretation, he said, rahimahullah, that the actions that Allah accepts, they are those actions that the person, he performed them with taqwa. And performing the action with taqwa means that a person, he performed it seeking the face of Allah alone, sincerity and purity for the sake of Allah alone, in accordance to his command, in accordance to his deen. And this can never happen except with knowledge. وإذا كان هذا منزل العلم وموقعه علم أنه أشرف شيء وأجله وأفضله ولا وعلم. So if this is the case now, this is the status of knowledge and this is the reality of knowledge, it is known clearly that knowledge is the most lofty and noble and the most virtuous of all things. The most virtuous and the best, the most virtuous and lofty of all things is to have knowledge. And the one who realizes this, he will wear himself out and spend his time and his life and his breath and his effort and his money and his wealth in seeking knowledge. And he will not sleep. So likewise, he mentioned, rahimahullah ta'ala, about this affair, and al-amil bila ilm kasair bila dalil wa ma'lumun anna ataba mithli hadha aqrabu min salamatihi wa in qudira salamatuhu ittifaqan nadiran fa huwa ghayru mahmud. So the one who is acting without knowledge, he is like the one who's going on a path without a guide. The one who's traveling through the land with no GPS, and he has no idea. He's in a strange land. Imagine someone in a strange land traveling with no GPS and no map. No GPS, no map, nobody to direct him, nobody who knows where to go. He's just driving by himself on the road. This is the example of the one who acts without knowledge. This is the example of the one who acts without knowledge. It's mentioned even if he safely made it to his destination, which is very rare, he's still considered ignorant. He's still considered blameworthy. And what would you go out on a path like this? You have no clue where you're going and drive around. And even if he made it, alhamdulillah, he's still considered blameworthy with people of intelligence. He says now, rahimahullah, wa kana shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala yaqul man faraqa ad-dalil dhalla as-sabil. Man faraqa ad-dalil dhalla as-sabil. Hadi min al-lu'lu' wa durr. This is from those gyms. These are from those gyms. You don't let somebody drop them and leave them. Man faraqa ad-dalil dhalla as-sabil wa la dalila illa bima ja'a bihi ar-rasul. Man faraqa ad-dalil dhalla as-sabil. وَلَا دَلِيلَ إِلَّا بِمَا جَاءَ بِهِ الرَّسُولُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Whoever goes away from the evidence, then he will be misled from the path. And there's no evidence except in that which the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم came with. مَنْ فَارَقَ الدَّلِيلَ ضَلَّ السَّبِيلَ. مَنْ فَارَقَ الدَّلِيلَ ضَلَّ السَّبِيلَ. And who does not have knowledge, or he did not apply his knowledge, he will go astray. Whoever does not put knowledge in front of him and follow that knowledge and implement it and make his creed, his belief, his actions, his statements, his deeds, all of that, his contract, his dealings, his life, his marriage, his disputes, everything based upon knowledge, then he will go astray. And there's no guide in this affair except for that which the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam came with. Except for that which the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam came with. Al-Hasan al-Basri, he mentions, العامل على غير علم كسالك على غير طريق والعامل على غير علم يفسد أكثر مما يصلح فاطلب العلم طلبا لا تضر بالعبادة واطلب العبادة طلبا لا تضر بالعلم فإن قوما طلبوا العبادة وتركوا العلم حتى خرجوا بأسيافهم على أمة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ولو طلبوا العلم لم يدلهم على ما فعلوا. الحسن البصري, he says, rahimahullah ta'ala, al-amilu ala ghayri ilmin kas-saliki ala ghayri tariq. The one who is working without knowledge, one who is working and doing these without knowledge, he's like a person who's traversing, but he's not on the right path. Wal-amilu ala ghayri ilmin yufsidu akthara mimma yuslih. And the one who works without knowledge, he does actions and deeds without knowledge, that which he corrupts and the mistakes and errors that he makes is more than the good that he brings. So therefore you should seek knowledge. فَاطْلُبُوا الْعِلْمَ طَلَبًا لَا تُضِرُّ بِالْعِبَادَةِ. So you should seek knowledge now, understanding this affair, in a manner that will not harm the worship. In a manner that will not harm the worship. وَاطْلُبُوا الْعِبَادَةِ طَلَبًا لَا تُضِرُّ بِالْعِلْمِ. And seek worship, seek to devote yourself in worship in a manner that will not harm the knowledge. Meaning that there must be moderation here. Some people, they will start to seek knowledge and they will learn a lot about the sunnah and the actions of worship and the means to draw near to Allah, but they will not apply them. For example, they will be dedicated to knowledge, learning the Qur'an, memorizing the Qur'an, learning how to recite the Qur'an, learning the narrations of the Prophet, learning the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but then they will not apply it. For example, they will study and they will learn and memorize narrations about the man salla thinti ashal tarakatan fi yawmin wa layla buniya lahu bihinna baytun fi jannah, that whoever prays 12 rak'ah in one day and one night, a house in paradise will be built for him. So he's learning narrations, memorizing narrations, and then he does not even pray the sunnah. Then he does not even pray the sunnah. So this is not the proper manner. Rather, a person, he will seek knowledge and strive, but at the same time, he will also strive to fulfill the rites of worship and to increase in the non-obligatory actions of worship. And he will not dedicate himself to knowledge until he never performs any non-obligatory actions of worship. And he will not dedicate himself to the non-obligatory actions of worship and not seek knowledge. Rather, he will combine between the two of them, and the knowledge will bring about this affair. And then he warned, rahimahullah ta'ala, from this, mentioning that individuals that had left the knowledge and they had advanced upon worship, and this led them to bring their swords out against the believers because they did not have knowledge. So they misunderstood the evidences and they apply the texts that are in reference to the kuffar to the Muslims. And he's talking about the Khawarij. And he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, if they had sought knowledge, they would not have done what they did. So in any case, we see that the sign that Allah, he wants good for someone, is that he will grant him an understanding in the religion. But the understanding of the religion is the understanding that is coupled with action. The understanding that brings about the fruit of action that changes one's life, changes one's manners, his behavior, his conduct, and his demeanor. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.